Well, we've had a quorum, so thank you for coming to this meeting. I believe that we would be finished with our work by having one to two meetings. I'm quite optimistic. We're just asking the government officials to explain to us what this is all about. So shall we invite the administration team in, please? Welcome, government officials. Let me introduce you first. The first on the first row, the PAS, Financial Services, Mr. Jackie Liu from FSTB, Assistant Secretary Financial Services, Mr. Henry Yim, and then from the Hong Kong Monetary Authority, Head External, Mr. Clement Lau, and on the second row is Ms. Melody Ho, Senior Government Counsel, DFJ, and also Ms. Emma Wong, Senior Government Counsel, and also Senior Manager External, Ms. Linda Zhang, Chair from the HKMA. Thank you for coming to this meeting. Colleagues, we have received the City Youth Dr. Nicholas Thomas, Associate Professor, who has given us a reply on this matter, and he has given us his views. And in a minute, perhaps we'll ask the clerk to discuss with us whether maybe we should invite him to come and discuss with us. Can the clerk update us on the replies that we have received from the academics? We have issued letters to seven universities, to the schools, Faculty of Business and Faculty of Social Sciences. And as of yesterday, we've received three replies. Two of them said that they have no particular comment, and the other one is coming from the City University, as what is mentioned by the Madam Chair. So that's my report. So, clerk and members, if you know him, please contact Dr. Nicholas Thomas to see if he's interested to come and give us a presentation. Now, may I now ask the government officials to brief us on this piece of subsidiary legislation, the paper that they've submitted. I've got to explain to the government team why we are setting up this subcommittee. We have so many international agreements that we have signed, and all along we've been very concerned about it. We have to discharge our international obligations, but how to do it? Different approaches are being adopted. Some are incorporating the international covenants into some appendixes, and sometimes they are being separately written as a piece of subsidiary legislation. As for the UNSC resolutions on sanctions, and we've been adopting a model in the past 7 to 8 years. Now, as for this AMRO Limited, an approach has been proposed, so we will explore into whether your proposal is suitable or not. So can we ask the government team to brief us on the order first? Well, thank you for inviting us to this meeting. Now, before this meeting, and in fact in response to the questions raised in the first meeting, we have given you a paper, and the paper number is LC paper number CB bracket 47691516 bracket 02, and we have replied in detail questions raised by members on this order. So if with your permission, can I brief members on the background to this order and also the privileges and immunities covered under the order. Now, by way of background, Hong Kong has been using the name Hong Kong, China, joined the Chiang Mai Initiative Multilateralization, CMIMI. This is a multilateral arrangement in which the ASEAN plus three members, including ASEAN 10 countries, and also PRC, Japan, and Hong Kong, to participate in this CMIM. And if any members have problems in relation to their balance of payments and short-term liquidity difficulties, then we will provide them with short-term liquidity support. Now, Hong Kong has been participating under Hong Kong-China in this CMIM to maintain financial stability in this region. Now, after CMIM was set up, members felt that there is a need to strengthen the macroeconomic, to monitor the macroeconomic status in the region. So in 2011, the members suggested that we should set up the Aeson Plus 3 Macroeconomic Research Office Limited, AMORL Limited. So in 2011, it was incorporated as a limited company in Singapore. And in 2014, member states felt that it should be upgraded to an international organization. So ASEAN plus Japan, PRC and Hong Kong have signed an agreement on AMRO on the 10th of October 2014, and the office has been upgraded to the status of an international organization. Now, Hong Kong has signed this agreement. Therefore, we need to establish this order so that by way of local legislation, the legal status of this AMRO and also the status of immunities and privileges should be incorporated into Hong Kong law. Now, in Hong Kong, we have the International Organization's Privileges and Immunities Ordinance, and it is an appropriate platform for us to deal with this matter. Now, in the appendix of this paper, we have given you extracts on provisions relating to privileges and immunities. Section 18 and 19 are the main provisions, and Article 18 relates to the immunity of AMRO, and all the member states agreed to give this immunity to the AMRO, and the AMRO enjoys immunity from relevant legal process, and the property and assets, archives and other documents would not be free from seizure. And also the archives shall be inviolable, and its official communication shall not be interfered with, and its assets, properties, incomes will also enjoy exemptions. And Article 19 relates to the privileges and immunities of AMRO personnel. Now, say if they have, with respect to their words spoken and written and acts performed in their official capacity, and they shall enjoy inviolability, and also in respect of their official papers and documents. And the members of the AMRO shall also enjoy immunities from immigration restrictions. And they are the same as accorded by each member to the representatives and staff of comparable rank of any other member. And also AMRO personnel shall be exempt from taxation on the salaries and emoluments paid to them. Now, according to Article 21, such immunities and privileges are not granted for the personal benefit of the individuals themselves, but rather for the overall interest of the AMRO, and the office can waive such immunities and privileges. And China, Hong Kong has assigned to this agreement, and all the privileges and immunities provided in this agreement are commensurate with those in the other member states. I know that members have asked about the other international organizations covered under the International Organization's Privileges and Immunities Ordinance, but then these other international organizations may not be the same as its AMRO, but then their privileges and immunities are broadly comparable to those being granted under AMR proposed. And these other international organizations include International Monetary Fund, Bank for International Settlements, International Bank for Reconstruction and Development, International Finance Corporation, and World Trade Organization. I must emphasize that we are granting privileges and immunities to these international organizations and the representatives. Our overriding principle is that they would be able to perform their proper functions efficiently. But then for ASEAN plus 3, AMRO, well, as far as we understand, does not plan to set up any office in Hong Kong. So the chance for these privileges and immunities to be invoked by their personnel will be limited. But then they might have to visit Hong Kong to carry out their macroeconomic surveillance duties, and they may need to exercise such privileges and immunities. So under such circumstances, law enforcement agencies would, according to the government's established procedures, refer such cases to the relevant bureaus and departments for handling. I'll be happy to take any questions. HKM, do you have anything to supplement? The paper mentioned that you are one of the parties monitoring the operation of the AMRO. What's your relationship with this AMRO? Madam Chair, as what the officer said, the AMRO in its daily operations is being monitored by the Executive Committee. And the Executive Committee comprises financial ministers from the ASEAN plus 3 and also the HKMA's assistant director is also a member of this executive committee and monitoring the operation of this office. Members who have raised their hands to ask questions, we don't have many members here, so I won't set a time limit. Please exercise self-discipline in questioning. Perhaps others would also like to interrupt at any time because you may share similar views or questions. First, Mr. Dennis Kwok, followed by Mr. Kenneth Chan. Thank you, PAS, for your briefing. I would like to ask about the staff number of this office and who is appointing these staff members. Although it's not an office is not being planned in Hong Kong, but overall speaking, how's the staff number like? Thank you, Mr. Kwok, for your question. The headquarters is in Singapore, and it's just been several years since its establishment, and it's now gradually building up its operation. To our understanding, there are now 40 odd staff members and experts working on macroeconomic surveillance on ASEAN plus 3 countries. The work location is mainly in Singapore, but because of work duties, they may go on visits and conduct economic studies in different areas. HKMA, there are two purposes of this office. They will do analysis and study and try to ascertain the financial and economic situations of these ASEAN plus 3 countries. This is an ongoing exercise. And the other thing is, annually, visits will be made. So that's the arrangement for every member nation. There will be annual visits to the agreement or the member states to have a first-hand experience and also try to understand the situation there.
So would there be any financial expert from Hong Kong going to the Singaporean office, or would personnel in Singapore just send out people to other cities such as to Hong Kong? Thank you for your question. According to our understanding, no one now is employed by AM RO, but if they're extending their scale, then we would not exclude the possibility that there would be personnel in Hong Kong to engage in such work. But right now, from what we understand, there are not anybody from Hong Kong in this organization. Well, I see the submission from Dr. Nicholas Thomas, and he calls upon the Hong Kong government to engage in financial policies in East Asian countries. So what are your plans for that? Thank you, Mr. Kwok, for your question. We've always been in support of the ASEAN Plus 3 Macroeconomic Research Office in the past few years through the HAMA, through participation in giving our recommendations. Perhaps I could ask our HAMA representative to voice his views. Well, you don't have to thank the chair every time. I mean, if you are honest in your answers, then you know we are the ones who would have to express our gratitude. Thank you. The implementation or the Executive Council, we do have people there to the Executive Committee will be looking into research analysis and also to look into the financial situation of the region and to give recommendations. And under the Executive Committee, there are also other committees and subcommittees, and we have representatives from the HAMA to join in these discussions. There are on-site visits, and the reports would be circulated to all participating members so that all members will be able to provide recommendations on the financial policies in the area. Thank you. Mr. Chen Kalok, thank you. I see that this office was set up in Singapore, and it was set up as a company limited by guarantee, and now through the Chiang Mai Initiative multilateralization, it will now be established as an international organization. And today, we're discussing how to empower AMRO as an international organization and how we uphold our responsibilities. Well, if you take a look at the submission given by the City University of Hong Kong, it seems that there's a deputy director recruitment which will be conducted in June this year in Hong Kong. So Para 10 right now doesn't seem to say anything about setting up an office in Hong Kong. But I know that if we have such a deputy officer coming into Hong Kong, then we do have to give him privileges and immunities. So if a deputy officer is to be recruited and this person will come to Hong Kong to work, I want to understand what nature of the work would be and how under the CMIM will this person be carrying out his duties in Hong Kong. Well, this may not be something familiar to the public in Hong Kong. First, we're talking about an office that they can set up a branch or an office in Hong Kong. But they've already established an office in Singapore. They have over 40 people working there. And another concept is the people. As this office is already established, then these 40-odd people or maybe even more in the future will enjoy privileges and immunities. So even in Hong Kong, even though we do not have this bricks and mortar office or a branch, as long as the personnel comes from Singapore and they are part of the team of AMRO, that after they enter Hong Kong, how would the government know of these personnel entering our city, and how can we be able to exercise such privileges and immunities in appropriate circumstances? Thank you. Thank you, Madam Chair. Well, Mr. Chan has two questions. I'll first answer the first one. First of all, I have to thank City University for giving us a submission. We only received this submission a couple of hours ago. I really thank Dr. Nicholas Thomas for her support. He said that yes, a deputy director would be recruited in June. But our understanding is that the recruitment, even though a director is to be recruited, the personnel would be based in Singapore. So I'm not sure whether the office has considered posting the deputy director in Hong Kong. I can go back and talk to them and then come back with a more definite answer. But according to my understanding so far, any recruitments would be posted in Singapore. The second question, whether the personnel is based in Hong Kong or not, as long as the personnel pass through Hong Kong or enter Hong Kong, then they'll be able to exercise the immunities and privileges under the order. And when the personnel enter Hong Kong, according to our usual practice, they would first communicate this to our relevant departments so that we would be sure to know of their arrival. They may not necessarily exercise privileges and immunities because they may just be passing through Hong Kong because of work. When they think that there is a need to use the diplomatic channel for immigration, then in accordance with the order, then they're able to go through that channel. But it doesn't mean that they will necessarily make use of such privilege. However, if the personnel wants to exercise the privilege and immunity under the order, then the personnel must first notify the government. Well, yes, you know, I mean, they can use the diplomatic channel for immigration and maybe enjoy airport lounges. Well, this is something that the Hong Kong government will be able to provide. I want to try to understand that the personnel may choose to notify you of their identity, or, you know, they can use the discretion. I mean, what if they come for both work and leisure? They may come to visit the HMA, but they may also come for personal purpose. So would that be a special circumstance? I mean, because if it is only for work purpose, then of course we understand. But you know, this is not really government officials that we are talking about. We're talking about the AMRO here. The personnel is, you know, more down to earth. So how can you ensure that when they exercise privilege and immunities, it would be solely based on work purposes? Regarding the privileges and immunities under the AMRO order, they can only do that when they are on official work visits. So even if they are passing through Hong Kong because of personal reasons, then they would not be able to exercise their privileges and immunities. Because if they are to exercise such rights, then they would have to first notify us in advance. Otherwise, they would not be able to exercise such privileges and immunities. And these privileges and immunities are not for personal visits. Madam Chair, I want to follow up with a question. I understand that theoretically, of course, you know, work is work, leisure is leisure. Then if you're on a work visit, then you will be able to exercise such privileges and immunities. I am clear of that. How about if I put it in another way? Singapore is where the office is, and so the office in Singapore will be able to decide who will be regarded as personnel. And Singapore, the Singapore office will know when they are here for official visits so that they could enjoy their privileges and immunities. So ultimately, it will be based on the Singapore office that when the personnel comes to Hong Kong, are they on work visits or maybe an official business? Thank you for your question. We will draw reference from the information given to us by the office in Singapore whether they are on official business, but it doesn't mean that we would defer the decision to the office in Singapore. When the government allows using the privileges and immunities, we will also consider whether they have the right to do so. If there are any controversial issues, then of course we would need to go to court to see whether the personnel can enjoy such privileges and immunities. But it is not, as Mr. Chen said, that the office in Singapore will have the ultimate decision on who will be able to subject to such rights. I am sure that you know, this would be our discretion ultimately. Well, yes, I'd like to ask another question. Well, the office is based in Singapore, so when personnel come through Hong Kong, they would notify us or notify the government that, you know, these are personnel from their office. Well, the government said that it's not entirely up to information from the office. So that means, you know, the office can also take back the privileges and immunities from certain personnel. Now, let's say this office said, oh, you know, Mr. Chen Kalok is not part of our personnel anymore, so he will not be able to enjoy such privileges and immunities. So would you also do an individual assessment instead of just using the information given by the Singapore office? Well, we look at this not from the personal level, but at the official level. So when we have information, we'll be able to make a judgment very early on to see whether the person coming through Hong Kong is part of AMRO personnel. If a person is not working at the office anymore and we have clear information, then the government will not empower any privileges and immunities to that person, because we know that he is already not part of the office. If there are any doubts or under special circumstances when we are not sure whether the personnel really belongs to the Singapore office, then we will communicate with the office to see whether this person still belongs to such office. So if the identity is not clear, the government will, to our best ability, confirm the identity of the personnel before the privileges and immunities can be exercised.
Thank you. Now, when we go to close by close scrutiny, the members may ask you about Article 19B and C. One is what you call immigration restriction. We don't know what it is. And then C, you mentioned about traveling facilities. And that's something mentioned by the member. VIP passageway, counselor passageway, and so on. So in terms of actual operation, will the AMRO personnel will have, say, the wordings consulate stated clearly in their passport, and that they can use the consulate passageway? Or is it the case that when they come to Hong Kong for official duties, a notification has to be made to the Hong Kong government first, and then you can tell the customs to make the necessary arrangements? You may need information, say, on the flight number, the arrival time, departure time, etc. So how does it operate in effect? Thank you, Madam Chair. With regard to travelling facilities, I may not have information on hand now. With regard to the passports, I don't know whether they're going to be issued by the Singapore government or the authorities in their place of birth, or the and whether there is this marking that there are a counsellor, members of the consulate general as in their password. Well, I don't know yet. Now, irrespectively, if the AMRO personnel come to Hong Kong for official duties and they notify us that they need to use the consular passageway, if we receive such requests, we will notify the enforcement bodies, including the law enforcement units in the airport, and to make the necessary arrangements to provide convenience, which is the same granted to consulate staff. And also VIP service can also be provided. But if they don't make that request, that means that they don't need to exercise the immunities and privileges, then they can do it in the usual way, in coming and leaving Hong Kong. Mr. Lee Chuck Yan, followed by Mr. Alan Leung. I won't put a limit on the timing. I will let you have all the answers you need. The AMRO will not be set up in Hong Kong, but then AMRO personnel may come to Hong Kong for official duties. Mr. Lee Chuck Yan.
Thank you, Madam Chair. You talk about immunities. The immunities are rather broad. Words spoken, his acts, and so on. Words spoken and written and acts performed by them. So all the criminal and civil proceedings do not apply to them, is that right? And also, if something happens, say for example, if he has a car accident, he has immunity. So even if somebody gets injured in the accident by the driver, then he cannot be taken to court, right? Now, after, say, he leaves the office in 1 year's time, what happens to the immunity? So what is the protection to local citizens if immunity is granted to them? Is the immunity scope too wide? So I want some clarification. And also, is there any retrospective effect on certain acts? Say, is there a bar date on traffic accidents? Now, after the bar date, he's not having immunity. So how would you deal with such situations? Third, going by what you say, he may come and does not declare that he is on official duty, and then after something untoward happens, and he says he's on official duty. I don't think that should happen. Is that right? He must notify the SARG of his official capacity and that he is having official duties in Hong Kong, and before he can enjoy the immunity. So it doesn't work the other way around. Say, if he comes in and as an MRO personnel, but he's not declaring he's here for official duty, then he can't claim immunity afterwards. Is that right? Now, in relation to Article 19 of the agreement, which is also copied onto the order, and that is, these people shall be immune from legal process. And such immunity will be limited to words spoken and written, acts performed by them in their official capacity. But, of course, we can't make generalizations. Say, in the case of a traffic accident, whether that accident involves him in his official capacity. I think we have to look at individual situations. So generally, we say that they will only be protected when they act in their official capacity. For any acts or behavior done outside the official capacity, that won't be protected. So I think this point is very clear. And also the AMRO personnel are also clear about the scope of the protection in different jurisdictions. Because the exercise of privileges and immunities may differ from case to case, I can't make any generalizations. Now, if something untoward happened, the AMRL personnel may come forth and declare their official capacity, and then they can exercise the privileges and immunities. Going by established practice, before they come to Hong Kong, they will, of course, notify Hong Kong in advance. And if such protections are incorporated into the constitution of this international organization, so going by established practice, they will notify us before they come to Hong Kong. Now, in the case of what Mr. Li Chiu-en said, that they haven't notified us in advance, and when they are in Hong Kong, they work on some official duties, then they declare their status only when they're in Hong Kong, then that would be more complicated because we have to ask more detailed questions on them. We have to ask them why they're in Hong Kong and why and the RC head office, why they are in Hong Kong, and whether certain acts are being done in their official capacity. So that may be more complicated than if they have already declared or notified us in advance. Well, normally they would notify us in advance and we have an idea of their official duties in Hong Kong. So their protection is limited to words spoken and written and acts performed by them in their official capacity. So you are drawing the line on whether they are acting in their official capacity or not. So my question is, there is a traffic accident, and at that time they are in their official capacity. But then after that traffic accident, they have left the office. So do they still enjoy the immunity? It seems probably so. So the immunity will stretch all the way, even after they've left the office. And you can't institute legal proceedings against them. Well, that's what I understand you to be saying. Once immunity is granted, even if the personnel has left, then the immunity still goes on, right? Well, I think we have the material time concept. At that juncture, when the act is performed and he is immune, then he is immune from the legal process. Now, say, after several decades, and he is no longer the AMRO personnel, then that doesn't matter, because when the act was being done, then he, at that time, was immune from the legal process. So we can't take him to court. Now, Article 19 talks about the AMRO personnel, and Article 18 is on privileges and immunities of AMRO. 18.1 said that it shall enjoy immunity from every form of legal process. Does it include labor laws? So, say, in the case if they are going to set up an office in Hong Kong, would they be immune from the employment ordinances? For example, can they employ males and not females? According to 18.1, the AMRO shall enjoin immunity from every form of legal process. So, in other words, it is immune from legal process. Of course, it has to abide by the law of that place. But unless it expressly waives its immunity for the purpose of any proceedings or under the terms of any contract. So the key here is the legal process. I think it is protecting AMRO against any civil or criminal proceedings. But it doesn't mean that it doesn't have to abide by the laws in the in that jurisdiction. I don't think that's the case, because we can't institute any civil or criminal proceedings against him, even if it breaks the law. So that means that it doesn't have to abide by the law, right? Can you clarify? Can we ask the DOJ colleagues to clarify that point? Immunity from legal process. We are focusing on civil proceedings. If it is an organization, it may very often be signing contracts and may be involved in tenancy disputes and so on. So it says here that you shall enjoy the immunity from legal process, except that it expressly waives its immunity for the purpose of any proceeding or under the terms of any contract. The member may be concerned that it has too much power. Now, on this particular aspect, there has been a lot of discussion in the international community. So why we should be giving so much privileges and immunities to international organizations? Because such organizations are different from councillors or the state leaders. The latter are backed by the people of that jurisdiction. But for international organizations, they should do something which benefits the international community. They may be relatively more fragile, and they may face greater difficulties in exercising their duties in different jurisdictions. So as to the members' question on why they shall enjoy immunity from legal process, well, that was drawn up based on the consideration that they may have to go to different jurisdictions to discharge their duties. So if they are bound by such legal process, then great inconvenience will be caused. Say, for example, the personnel may do something, may speak on something, and there is immunity. Because there are indeed cases whereby international organization members or personnel have spoken something, and they are taken to court for slander or libel. So they do have such difficulties in discharging their duties. So it is difficult for them to discharge their duties.
So you could mean?
Well, as there is a need for such waiver in their official capacity, usually a few circumstances would be considered. First, to look at the function of the international organization, as each international organization has different functions. It's very difficult to have the exactly same assessment for all. And as these international organizations will be different areas, we want to ensure that there will not be so many limitations. And thirdly, we would also look at tax arrangements. For international organizations, the income usually comes from a few different countries, and if you're able to levy tax in some countries, then a certain member will be able to make a profit out of the tax. Therefore, exemption from tax on salaries and emoluments will allow them to better employ talents for their organizations. Mr. Alan Leung. Thank you, Madam Chair. How these international organizations exercise privileges and immunities is not something that I have learned in my training, so I am not an expert in this area. I hope that the government will be able to clarify some points for me. Let's look at Article 17, 18, and 19. It looks like international treaties that, for example, in Article 19, that they have a lot of immunities. Well, I am not disrespecting the organization, but I do want to know, maybe Ms. Hui can help me clear up some points. That is this a tactic of international organizations? Is this easy to operate? And I do want to know the countries in ASEAN plus three. Have the other countries also exercised such law? I look at the English version. Is this called a legal notice? Because it's called an order. So in under Ord 3, the verb used on the agreement establishing ASEAN plus three macroeconomic office, the verb used is done. So when we talk about agreements, then we use the word make. We do not use the verb do. So this should be made in Washington and not done in Washington. So why is the verb done used? Is this a unique way of drafting in Hong Kong? Well, if you use a way of international treaty to be put in an order in Hong Kong, and we face problems in operation, then you know the judge. Would the judge have the final decision, or would this be up to the administration? Let's say someone says that he can exercise the privileges and immunities under Articles 18 and 19, that he is in Hong Kong on official duties. Who will decide whether he is here on official business? Would it be up to the CEO from the office, or would this be decided by the judge in Hong Kong? I'm sure that the Hong Kong government has considered this thoroughly. Therefore, I would like to know the answer. I just hope that I can learn something. Thank you. Miss Hui, you are being too kind. We actually learn from each other. We don't have the right to decide when a person can receive or enjoy privileges and immunities. The government can only allow such immunities and privileges when papers are signed. It's just like this international organization, or just like under Cap 5-7 for consular officers. We would draft this all in our order, because we don't want any conflicts arising from our different versions. We hope to avoid such circumstances, and this is actually an agreement made by the central government with the organizations. Therefore, we would deal with it this way. Well, you ask how to handle it when there are controversies. This is already part of the law once it becomes effective, and so it would be under Hong Kong law. How do we decide whether a person is here on official business? I'm sure that when there are issues, then of course we would try to identify whether a person is really here under official capacity. If our paper is inconsistent with a paper, then how do we handle it? Under common law, there is a hypothesis that our local law should be in accordance with international law for such international treaties. And there is a clause under international treaty law that these people, when in Hong Kong on official business, would be able to enjoy such privileges and immunities. Therefore, the court will also look into this when they're making such decisions. In the past, we see that there are at least two methods to implement our international responsibilities. One is just like this one, and the other is on chemical weapons. The main law would be written in our usual way locally, and then to put the international treaty as part of the appendix. The other method is not to put this under our appendix, but to use the local drafting method to implement to write down the restrictions. Well, but this is a third method. Well, this would be put in our schedule. Order is also done and not made. Well, you know, that's a very trivial matter. I understand that. But the methods you just mentioned, Madam Chair, this one is quite different from the two you mentioned. If you do not put it down just like how we put down local law, then it would just give rise to conflicts. First of all, you could already use administrative measures to confuse people. You can just say that, well, you can use Article 18, Clause 3, or I can use that to decide whether to exercise my right. The judge would then have no way to make any decision. That would allow some people to have special privileges. But I'm not sure whether our law allows such privileges. So it's just like C.Y. Leung has the right to decide. Would that be included in our law? Well, as a lawyer myself, you know, I am not too happy about that. And I, as a legislator, in future, if I need to make any decision on Article 18 and 19, well, you try to put it in a local drafting manner right now, but then the judge would ask which legislator allowed this to be passed. I'm sure Ms. Ho also knows what I mean, that judges have once criticized legislators being unclear in the passing of the law. I am really a layman. I don't quite understand this, but then, Madam Chair, you clarified by giving me two usual methods that we use in Hong Kong for law drafting. I, as a legislator, am not sure whether I am actually passing something that would allow certain people to have special privileges that actually should not be given. Well, you said that you could add this to the schedule at the back, or through to put it in the main law right in the beginning. Well, but this, you know, is a new way that I have never seen and not mentioned by the chair. I really am not sure how this could be operated in Hong Kong. Or maybe, as Ms. Hoi said, we can all learn from each other. You know, I just want to try to get a better understanding. Or I can try to clarify, and then Ms. Hoi can supplement. Under Article 588 in under Hong Kong law, there are already 7 or 8 orders that are under this in relation to international organizations that was passed in the year 2000. And that empowers the chief executive together with the executive council to announce the position, privileges, and immunities enjoyed by international organizations. And that, under the main law, allows the chief executive and the executive council to make such a decision. All my understanding is that the order under international organizations will only need to clarify the part on privileges and immunities instead of writing out the entire law out again. And that, if put under the schedule, would allow international organizations to enjoy the privileges and immunities under international organization law. And orders would include Hong Kong World Trade Organization, in IMF, and Bank for International Settlements, etc. Altogether, 8 to 9 organizations that already have such privileges and immunities granted to them. I'm sure that we can ask our draftsman and Ms. Hui to supplement on this. Thank you.
Before Ms. Hui says anything, I would like to ask Mr. Liu a question. I don't know whether civil and criminal liabilities are involved in the 6 to 7 orders previously made. I must admit that I'm quite ignorant on this area. Now, the difficulty that I can imagine is this. For any international agreements, they are usually put in a sort of more conceptual approach. They are contain broad principles only. But Mr. Liu, you should know that if we talk about local legislation in Hong Kong, the legislation should be written in a way, in such a way that there is no gray area in implementation. So the wordings, the drafting of these two different types of documents are different. So when two nations sign an international agreement, each of them will go back to their own parliament or legislature to seek confirmation of the same. Now, after the confirmation is done, and if local legislation is needed to give power to this international agreement, the local jurisdiction will use a local drafting method to draft a piece of local legislation. And so the agreement, the international agreement, can then be implemented into the two nations. So that's the perspective from a layman. But for this order tabled in front of me, it is replicating the terms and the provisions of the original agreement. It's just like putting a square peg in a round hole, or vice versa. So this is something that I am at a loss. Maybe I'm being ignorant here. If that is the case, then I'm waiting to hear from you further. Have I made myself clear, Madam Chair? Well, for myself, I have not been following through the international privileges and immunities in relation to international financial institutions. Another related body is the UNSC, and they are imposing sanctions. So can the government team explain to us under what circumstances where you will be replicate exactly the wordings of the international agreements in our local legislation? And when will you, as what you do with the UN sanctions, draft out the legislation clearly so that it is it can operate in Hong Kong? Now, for the UN sanctions, from 1999 to up to now, we are drafting the local legislation in the local language. Well, this is really a process which has taken 10 to 12 years to complete, and Dr. Margaret Ng has worked on it. So can you tell us why there are three models that you are adopting in relation to the international agreements? And also, Ms. Hui said that this is something of a diplomatic nature. Can I ask this question? If there are lawsuits in relation to this agreement, should we consult the CPG? Or is it the case that because it's already a piece of local legislation, and if the AMR OPAS personnel is contravening the legislation and he's doing something which doesn't enjoy immunity, should we be consulting the CPG when we take that person to court? Yes. DFJ, let me address your question from the drafting angle. As what the PAS explained, this is a piece of subsidiary legislation. We have to rely on cap fee 558 in our interpretation, and in section 3 of that ordinance, it says that the C in Council will announce certain provisions and orders. And what we're doing now is that this provisions will come into force as law in Hong Kong. No, so this is the only thing that we can do under the subsidiary legislation, as what the PS said. Under 558, the other pieces of subsidiary legislation are drafted in the same way as we are doing now for this piece. You are just declaring that these provisions can apply in Hong Kong, but that doesn't mean that you can actually implement such provisions. Now, maybe you would take these provisions to the judge and ask him to make a ruling. But these provisions are not implementable at all. So what will happen? I'm not familiar with Cap 558. Madam Chair, maybe you can lend me a hand. You have been working on such subsidiary legislation for 8 to 9 years. I'm not clear about the concept. Say, if the CE declares that Article 18 and 19 applies in Hong Kong, and that's it. And then these will not become part of Hong Kong laws. Well, can I get this clear? According to Cap 558, Articles 18 and 19 have not yet become part of the statutory law in Hong Kong. Is this the right concept? If this is right, then I don't have any further questions. Mr. Leung, thank you for your question. In the order, we have set out clearly that certain provisions in this international agreement will have the force of law in Hong Kong. So if we declare, say, Articles 18, 19 have the force of law in Hong Kong, then they will become part of the statutory law in Hong Kong. And this order is a piece of subsidiary legislation under International Organizations, Privileges and Immunities Ordinance. So this already becomes part of Hong Kong laws. Madam Chair, well, it is stated that it have the force of law in Hong Kong. It cannot be interpreted otherwise. Now, the question here is this. Let me cite an example. If we go to Article 18, Subsection 7, well, okay, I will read out the section in Chinese. AMRO is assets, property, income, and its operations and transactions shall be exempt from all taxation and from all customs duties. In Hong Kong laws, well, that would not be the way it would be drafted, because you leave a lot of room for people's interpretation. It says its assets. What are its assets? Cash? Properties? Documents? Property. What is the difference between assets and property? Now, in the normal local legislation, we would normally have a subsection too. We will differentiate between assets and property and income. What is income? And its operations and transactions. What do you mean by operations and transactions? I don't want to be long-winded. Perhaps I'm being very ignorant here, but I risk being criticized as ignorant. Well, we are, all of us don't know, don't have an idea. Well, I thought, Madam Chair, you've already served as a chairman for 8 and 9 years. Well, we're familiar with those pieces of legislation which are written in the local style. All right, let me turn back to Article 18.7, the first sentence of 7, the sentence before the full stop. Let's focus on that. If this sentence becomes part of local laws, and in certain circumstances, we ask the judge of the CIFI of High Court to understand this sentence. So I would like to ask, how shall we provide any help at all to the court? Well, I would try to be give an explanation. I'm not a lawyer by training, but I think it's clear. Now, if we have already consulted the relevant departments and see if there are any difficulties in implementation. Now, Article 18, bracket 7, we're talking about taxation and customs duties. Say, for example, if the office buys properties in Hong Kong and does some financial transactions, the Commissioner for Inland Revenue and also the Commissioner of Customs would think that tax and customs should be levied. But then when that is the case, the AMRO can, by invoking 18.7, say that it does not have to pay local taxes on its or customs duties on its assets and properties. Now, the government should already know that this office enjoys immunities and privileges, and if the Commissioner for Inland Revenue does know about this, then he would not be invoking taxation and customs duties legislation to levy tax and customs duties on this office. Now, even if this is being done by the relevant departments, this office can still invoke this article and apply for exemption, and that is they don't have to pay any tax and customs duties. If there are any disputes, they will be ruled upon by the court, and perhaps the Commissioner for Inland Revenue and the AMRO would come forth with their legal points and ask the court to make a ruling interpretation. and to make a ruling on whether a certain transaction falls under this exemption article or whether tax should be levied. So this is how we are dealing with such situations. Now, Mr. Ellen Leung's question on 7, on taxation, I think we are very clear about that.
WTO or IMF, IMF or Bank for International Settlements, any activities involving tax or stamp duty would already be very clearly waived under the law. Tax exemption is regular practice for international organizations. I'm sure that other countries would also have their own measures on how to make arrangements for international organizations. I understand Mr. Leung's comment that Article 18, bracket 7, is not as accurately put as our inland revenue tax law. But if we are to implement this locally, as this is legally binding in Hong Kong and the court has the ultimate decision, if the government and the international organizations have different interpretations on the law, then that would be decided by the court. Usually, if arrangements are made between the two parties, the court would not be needed to make any judgment. Thank you. Well, I think I have a better idea. Let me follow up with another question. Cap 558, starting from the year 2000, there have been 7 or 8 laws made for international organizations. So can I assume that these have never been brought to the court since the year 2000? I'm sorry, Madam Chair, I do not have this information on hand, but I have not heard of it, but I can't give you a definite answer right now, but I can go back and look into the issue. All right. I just want to understand so that I can smooth out my thoughts. If that's the case, then these would not be put before Hong Kong courts. Because this would be on an international level at the diplomatic level. Maybe I am being over anxious. Or even if this would not be brought before court, you would still have to make sure that this is put down on paper right now, because this all goes down to the international arrangements made between the parties and the related international organization will deal with any issues in an administrative manner. Well, I'm actually trying to think from the perspective of the court, because the judges will not understand and they can only make an understanding based on paper. Of course, everybody would say that any issues ultimately could be decided by the courts. Well, this has worked for the past 10 odd years. I'll not insist on you giving an answer again, but I do want to ask another question which has not been answered, which is whether Indonesia, Singapore, Cambodia, all the ASEAN plus three have already legislated on this. Madam Chair, well, if Hong Kong, China can participate, of course, we would support and monitor the international organization to ensure that the work done will be beneficial to maintaining regional stability, and that they are allowed privileges and immunities under local law. There should not be too many conflicts arising from this, because if we have the right to participate in AMRO, we would also have the right to leave the organization. In regards to Mr. Leung's second question, have other countries also legislated? I could ask my colleague to share more information, but usually when a city or a participating country has to do such a this, I understand that Singapore has also done something similar to our order to allow it to be passed in Singapore. And that's more important in Singapore because the office is based in Singapore. Does it mean that it would be legally binding with a signature by the director? It really depends on the country. For Japan, Korea, they do not go by the common law. So they may not lead this legislature. But for those adopting common law, then usually, then every time they enter or join a new international organization, then a order would be implemented to put this under local law, and that is usual practice for places using the common law. Now, DOJ, you should really consider, because we use different versions for the different organizations. So which one is actually the best one and the most appropriate one? I think the DOJ should really try to consider this. Otherwise, having such differences is not ideal for us. I want to follow up Mr. Alan Leung's question. If you just put all these articles into our schedule, then you're actually not foreseeing that any amendments would be made, right? Let's say the term assets. For the anti-terrorism law, a jewelry is also considered assets. But you're actually from financial services, so I guess you wouldn't need to put in jewelry for your assets, right? There is, you know, a diplomatic side to this, and amendments may not be accepted. But the DOJ should think of a more appropriate, consistent manner when dealing with such international organizations. There are many countries in ASEAN plus three, and in defining such privileges and immunities, our objective is to ensure that there will be smooth implementation and execution of AMRO. Therefore, these privileges and immunities are based on these premises. Members who have a different interpretation on the terms could go through certain mechanisms, such as going through discussions. There's already a mechanism set in case there are conflicts. Any other follow-up questions? Mr. Chen Kalok. Thank you, Madam Chair. Well, I think we should support this order. This is a negative vetting process. If we are to spend time to discuss each and every concept, it could take a very long time. But this order would become effective in April, and that would be pretty much impossible for us to do that. Well, yes, I understand that there would be very broad terms for international organizations because there are different modes of operation and definitions in the different countries. And I do understand for Hong Kong, we do have experiences in this as well. Maybe the court does not have any experience in differentiating whether such terms, for example, office personnel and their capacity in Hong Kong may not be very clear. And this the official capacities may even be broader than the personnel from WTO. So I will not, I do not think that this would bring along too much misinterpretation. And we're not talking about too big of a gray area. But we do want the government to explain to us the operation. Mr. Liu introduced to us a cap. 588. I see from Article 4 that the CS should set out proof or clarification that when personnel of such international organizations come to Hong Kong, should they be entitled to privileges and immunities under the law, and according to according to Chapter 4, I think they're able to do that. But when we first legislated in the year 2000, did we really do this based on the government monitoring the situation, and when do you need to use Article 4? Because Article 4 also relates to Article 19 under the Basic Law, that if this is brought before the court, then it would also be considered under diplomatic law, and that the CE would need to demonstrate whether this person is working at the diplomatic level. So what kind of mechanism does the government use to ensure that the personnel in Hong Kong are actually here on official business? Or do we actually ask the CS whether that person is entitled to such rights? I hope that the government could give us such an answer. Well, yes, if we really bring this before the court, do we also have to ask the central government whether proceedings should be instituted. Well, I will try to answer both your questions. First of all, thank you, Mr. Chen, for your support on the order. You mentioned Article 4 under Cap 558. We're talking about proof and evidence here. It means that when the court needs to decide on whether a person is entitled to such privileges and immunities, the court will need to establish the capacity of the personnel, and proof and evidence would need to be provided. According to Article 4, if a person is doubtful of evidence, the CS will need to provide a de facto evidence, which means that this proof of evidence could be invincible in the court as the sole piece of evidence in court.
So this helps what to ascertain the facts. So this will be something issued by the CS for administration. Ms. Sito also asked this question. Basically, Article 13 says out clearly that the CBG is responsible for the diplomatic affairs of the SARG, and the immunities and privileges for consulates general are part of diplomatic affairs. So the CBG has a duty on that, and in exercising such privileges and immunities, we need to consult the CPG's office in Hong Kong, because under the basic law, giving immunities and privileges is considered a diplomatic affair, and the CPG is responsible for that area. I'd like the government officials to give us a paper on the provisions that you mentioned about the in the basic law that you mentioned. We signed to such international agreements, and then these agreements become part of the local legislation. As to how we should implement such local provisions, we have to seek the advice of the CPG on how to implement them. So, government, can you give us a paper setting out the flow of the process? In the next term of government, the next term of the Legislative Council, I don't know who will be looking at these matters, but any case, whoever is looking at how to turn international agreements into local legislation and how we should implement such local legislation, then we have a paper to go by. And also perhaps a clerk can collate the information discussed today and then provide the same to the next term of the legislature. So there is an official answer and setting out the official process. Yes, Madam Chair, we can work together with the government departments. I don't think there is a problem. We can give you the paper. If you don't, that new members may come on board for the next term, and they may also ask the same questions. Well, if you do it like what you did with the UN sanctions, and that is, we all agree that we would use a local drafting method and draft a piece of local legislation, then that's something different. But then this case round is different because you're giving privileges and immunities, and you are not imposing sanctions. So because of that, you may adopt different approaches. So that's why we need a document from the government to explain to us how the entire process works. Yes, no problem, Madam Chair. I have to consult the relevant government department. I'm now here in my capacity as an officer in the FSTB, and I have to consult other government departments.
But what I said is in line with what the government's is in line with the government's stance all along, and how we implement provisions in our laws in relation to diplomatic affairs. Yes, please do that. Well, I don't expect you not to give us a paper after you've consulted the government departments, right? Dr. Kenneth Chang, yes, I agree with you. We are here to gatekeep for the legal and also the public. We want to clarify how things work. And I would like to thank the legal secretariat for preparing this background paper for us, but it sets out that when the order was passed, the FA panel was not consulted. Well, because for the past 7 or 8 or similar orders made, nobody asked any questions. We have provided an information paper to the FAP. Well, we're not the FAP, so our concern is different from theirs. We understand. Well, we have to look at the basic structure of the order and how it's going to be implemented. Well, the principal legislation is Cap 558. Another related point is this. Since the government will prepare a paper related to financial services, if you look at the background there, in 2009, CIMIM was discussed. And the background to this is within the region, how the different jurisdictions should support each other in financial affairs. And we have to be pooling our funds together. The mechanism has never been triggered, though. And our contribution is rather great. Hong Kong has undertaken to commit is $8.4 billion. That's our commitment, right? Has been doubled from the very beginning. So this is liquidity level committed by Hong Kong. And in 2009, some members have some questions, had doubts on that. Is there a basis for the government to do that? We participated in this mechanism to stabilize financial situation in Hong Kong, but will there be a mechanism before that is triggered? We just don't want to be notified merely. We want to participate in the whole process, because if we're talking about the financial stability in the region, I think we need to understand. And if discussions can be held at the legal, then the public will get to understand how the entire mechanism works. Yes, can the HAMA explain how the mechanism works? The secretary's background sets out that the FS was making that decision under the Exchange Fund Ordinance. And the FS was given power to do certain things to maintain financial stability. And he can put the exchange fund to the right use. So that was the legal basis mentioned at that time. But if Dr. Chan would like to learn more, then we can certainly provide some supplementary information. And apart from the legal basis, what about the amount? Does it mean that the FS can commit whatever amount he likes? How is that contribution amount determined? Is it the case that there is no limit to the commitment level? Is it all the FS discretion to decide on the commitment level? So can you give us a background paper on all that? Yes, I can certainly do that. For this $8.4 billion, we've never used it. It's just a pure commitment. And if needed, then we can do it. Well, it's the same approach is being adopted in EU. And so far, there has been no request to activate the emergency liquidity facility of CMIN. That's not been done. Well, that's very reassuring. So we've tried to safeguard our own financial system. as much as we can. Well, I understand all these, but we're talking about legal points, about the power given to the FS. Well, you can imagine that if there is really great volatility, then maybe the FS has the power to even double or triple the amount committed for the CMIM. Is it the case that under the relevant ordinance, the FS has all the power to do that? So please give us an answer. Well, if that is the case, can we go to the clause-by-clause scrutiny? That's relatively simple, because you can't make any amendments, because these are the terms of the international agreement. I don't think the government will accept any proposed amendments to the appendix. Well, let's go to the clause-by-clause scrutiny. Can Mr. Liu take us through this session? In fact, we've looked at some of the provisions in detail, but anyhow, let me take you through the provisions one by one. Okay, international organizations, privileges, and immunities. Ordinance commencement. This order comes into operation on the 27th of April, 2016. Second section, interpretation. Agreement means the agreement referred to in section 3.1. And also in this order, AMRO means the Aison Plus 3 Macroeconomic Research Office. Section 3, subsection 1, in my answer to Mr. Leung, we said that it is declared that the provisions of the agreement establishing Aison Plus 3 Macroeconomic Research Office have the force of law in Hong Kong. And for that purpose, are to be construed in accordance with subsections 3, 4, and 5, and that is set out in B. Now, subsection 2. A Chinese translation of the provisions of the agreement referred to in subsection 1 is also set out in the schedule. Subsection 3. In applying Articles 16, 18, and 19B and C of the agreement, member in this order is to be construed as meaning of a member of AMRO. And applying Article 19 of the agreement, local citizens or nationals is to be construed as meaning Chinese nationals or Hong Kong permanent residents. Subsection 5. In applying Articles 19 and 21 of the agreement, experts performing missions for AMRO is to be construed as meaning professionals carrying out AMRO's purpose and functions under contract with AMRO. So these are similar provisions. There are similar provisions in similar orders. Yes, questions. 3(2), Chinese translation. Is it the is it being done in Hong Kong? And then we have to submit it for reference by Chinese-speaking countries as well. Well, the international agreement was signed in English, but there is no official Chinese translation. So the Chinese translation has been done by the DOJ. They used the most succinct legal language to do it. Well, we must have Chinese and English versions of law in Hong Kong, but then at the international level, there is no Chinese version. So in the case when there is a lawsuit, then we will go by the English version, right? Well, you have to look at the general interpretations and clauses ordinance, which says that both the Chinese and English versions have the force of law. But indeed, if there are disputes, then we will have to look at the interpretation of the local legislation and also the international agreement. And we also have to take reference of the Chinese translation. Let's go to the schedule now. Thank you, Madam Chair. As explained before, we are putting the Articles 16, 17, 18, 19, and 21 in the international agreements into this. And they have to do with the privileges and immunities given to this AMRO. We are just copying the relevant terms into this local legislation. 16 first. The legal status, privileges, immunities, and exemptions set out in this agreement shall be accorded to AMRO in the territory of each member to enable AMRO to effectively exercise its purpose and functions. So the purpose of such privileges and immunities is to enable the office to exercise its functions. Article 17, legal status of MAR. It shall have full legal personality and can enter into contracts, acquire and dispose of immovable and movable property, and institute legal proceedings. Can we stop a while, please, Mr. Liu? It's Article 17, bracket C, institute legal proceedings. Tai Chut and Tai Hei in Chinese. Members believe that we should use Tai Chut in Chinese, but we don't understand why, since 2 years ago, the DOJ have followed the mainland language and used Tai Hei instead. Mr. Liu, you said Tai Chut just now, and I don't know why we have to mainlandize such terms.
Oh, yes. Yes, it should be Tai Hei. Well, why do we use Tai Hei for institute? I would invite the draftsman to elaborate. No, it's all right. You know, we've discussed this for a very long time, and we should use, you know, the Hong Kong local term instead of using the mainland term. Yes, it should be Tai Hei. All right. Article 18, privileges and immunities of AMRO. Bracket 1, AMRO shall enjoy immunity from every form of legal process except to the extent that it expressly waives its immunity for the purpose of any proceedings or under the terms of any contract. 2, the property and assets of AMRO shall, wherever located and by whomsoever held, be immune from search, requisition, confiscation, expropriation, or any other form of seizure, taken or foreclosure by executive or legislative action. 3, the archives of AMRO and all documents belonging to it or held by it shall be inviolable. 4, to the extent necessary to carry out its functions, all property and assets of AMRO shall be free from restrictions, regulations, controls, and moratoria of any nature. 5, official communications of AMRO shall be accorded by each member treatment not less favorable than that it accords to the official communications of any other member. 6, no censorship shall be applied to the official correspondence and other official communications of AMRO. Nothing in this article shall be construed to preclude the adoption of appropriate security precautions to be determined by agreement between a member and AMRO. 7, we've already talked about it at Mr. Leung's request. AMRO, its assets, property, income, and its operations and transactions shall be exempt from all taxation and from all custom duties. AMRO shall also be exempt from any obligation for the payment of withholding or collection of any tax or duty. Mr. Liu, I don't think we can make any amendments to the schedule. How about we ask the council if there are any inconsistencies between the English and Chinese versions. I'm sure these are only some of the ways that we can make changes. Legal advisor, do you think that there are any issues to the versions? Well, we have already gone through the Chinese translation, and we think that it is consistent with the English version. All right, that's all right then. Thank you, Chairman. We're not going to raise any amendments. Otherwise, it would make it even more confusing for everyone. Members, any follow-up? Mr. Liu? Please provide us with the papers that we requested earlier on the information on the timeline so that the Secretariat can have a paper for the next office. The clerk, please. Well, the chairman of HouseCom has moved a motion to extend the vetting from March 16th to April 13th, but because there were other discussions, it was not able to be dealt with on March 16th, and the time for vetting has already expired. Well, yes, we thank you for coming over to clarify our questions today. So it will come into effect on April 27th. Yes, for sure. For sure on April 27th. Oh, yes, we're happy for you. Well, yes, we would supply you with the information you requested later on. Thank you. Thank you. I don't think we need another meeting. All right? Thank you. Thank you.